Just read through the passage of Scripture and then go and answer the first question only. What does God's word say? In that first empty column, just go verse by verse and pinpoint the outstanding facts. Remember, do not paraphrase. Don't put in your own words. Look for the nouns and the verbs and just list the outstanding facts. I'll give you about 8 minutes to do that, and then we'll come back and we'll share the list of facts. Okay, let me have your attention. And just to save time, I'm going to give you my list of facts, because facts are facts. So, like I said, it can be sort of tedious, but this is very necessary so that you know what God is saying. Then we can go to the next question to see what it means. All right, but my list of facts was something like this. Since we're on the same passage, yours should be something like this. Actually, my list is exactly like this. Yours should be something like this. Verse 10, the apostles reported to Jesus, they withdrew with him. Verse 11, the crowds heard and followed. He welcomed, healed, and taught. Verse 12, later the 12 said, send the crowd away to find food and lodging. Verse 13, he replied, you give them to eat. They answered, we only have 5 loaves and 2 fish. Verse 14, he said, have them sit down in groups of 50. Verse 15, the disciples did. Everyone sat. Verse 16, Jesus took the loaves and fish, gave thanks, broke them, gave them to his disciples to set before the people. Verse 17, all ate and were satisfied. The disciples picked up 12 baskets of broken pieces. All right, those are the facts of the passage. So once you've listed your facts, then you go to the next question, what does God's word mean? And for each one of those facts, you see if you can find a lesson or a spiritual principle that you can draw from that fact. If you have a lesson from one of the facts, we're going to go verse by verse. I'll call out the verse. If you have a lesson, just raise your hand, get the attention of one of the microphones, and if you can find somebody before the last person finishes so we can just keep it moving and not have to wait. But so we're going to go first. In verse 10, the fact was the apostles reported to Jesus. They withdrew with him. What could be a lesson that you would learn from that? Anybody from this side over here? And if you have a lesson that you want to share, just raise your hand. All right, you're going to have to get the attention of the mic, okay? Let's see, Angela right here. You have to put your hand up. Thanks.
Accept Jesus' leadership.
All right, to accept his leadership, that he's Lord, that they needed to report to him, okay? So that we need to report to him. That's a simple thing. And when you report to Jesus, think of what that could be. What is that when you report to him? It's just, I won't try to trick you, but it's prayer, isn't it? When we tell him about our day, or we tell him what we've been doing, and so we need to make time to report to him, to pray. All right, Brandy, did you have somebody? No, you're just talking for fun. All right, let's see. All right, right there, Angela.
Come to the Lord and trust in him.
To come to the Lord and trust. All right, and so they came to him, and they were sharing what they had done, and so they were reporting to him. And you know, prayer is not just a list of things that we ask him for. Prayer is talking to him and telling him what's on our heart and what we've been involved in, you know. And for them, they had been on a mission trip. They were excited and they wanted to tell him what they'd been doing. All right, let's go to the next verse. And we're going to try to take two from each verse just to prepare you. So verse 11, the crowds heard and followed. He welcomed, healed, and taught. And Brandy, have you got somebody?
It was 11.
Okay.
Oh, sorry.
Okay. All right, while she's finding it, is there somebody else? Okay, right here, Linda.
to welcome others.
He is the healer and teacher.
All right, he's a healer. And so we can come to him, can't we? With some of our, not just physical illnesses, but emotional illnesses, our hurts and our wounds, and he can heal our hurts and then teach us maybe what we can learn from them. And okay, Angela.
Well, from the verse before, they had planned to get together as a small group, but is the key word, and the crowds followed him, and he had to change plans.
Yes.
So to me, the lesson is be flexible with whatever God permits into your life.
Yes, okay, that sometimes interruptions can be an opportunity to serve the Lord and to minister for him. So that's a wonderful lesson, especially for mothers. We're interrupted umpteen zillion times during the day, but sometimes those interruptions are opportunities to just minister in his name. Brandy, did you get somebody? Okay, you've got somebody. Okay, is the mic on?
It's on.
She's just not speaking.
We're finding the verse.
Okay. In verse 11.
Just simply that we should welcome, speak to others, be friendly, help them.
You know, those are simple lessons, but think about it for a moment, that we're never an interruption to Jesus, right? So when we come to him, he always welcomes us. And not only does he make us feel welcomed when we come to him, but then in turn, we need to make others feel welcomed when they come to us. So I think that's a very sweet lesson to draw from that. All right, let's go to verse 12, where later the 12 said, send the crowd away to find food and lodging. Somebody in this section? Okay, there's somebody on the front row, but I don't know if they can get to you up here. Is anybody? Okay, here she comes. Okay, go ahead.
How often do we tell Jesus how to solve problems based on our own logic?
Okay, and we're not going to, and I hear somebody resonating with you, we're not going to put it in the form of a question yet. One lesson might be that sometimes we tell Jesus how to answer our prayers, right? We tell Jesus how to solve something. Like we have more wisdom than he does. All right, Angela, did you have somebody?
We just said ask Jesus first instead of taking charge of our own lives.
Okay, good. That we would ask him first instead of taking charge of our own lives. That's a great lesson, one that we need to learn and relearn, isn't it? In verse 13, he replied, you give them to eat. And they answered, we only have 5 loaves and 2 fish. Okay, Brandy?
Is that me?
Hi. Don't doubt Jesus' abilities if he asks. He equips.
Yeah, okay, good. And so if he has us do something, then we know he's going to equip us to do it. We don't have to question it. He knows what he's doing. All right, Angela?
Don't be so selfish. Feed those people.
Okay. Don't be so selfish. Feed those people. All right, but they didn't have anything, right? So did you learn something from that, 5 loaves and 2 fish, when he said to see what they had and they only had a little bit? And I just think it's, all right, right here, there's somebody. Have you got somebody in the middle? Thank you.
Don't limit God. God gave over and abundantly.
Okay, so don't limit God. And, you know, when he told them to examine what they had, they really didn't have enough themselves, did they? So if this was going to get done, he would have to help them. So I think sometimes he wants us to see what we have, that we don't have enough, that we're inadequate to do what we're doing, but then he can work in and through us. All right, we're going to move on to the next verse. 14, have them sit down in groups of 50. Anybody, let's see, in this section over here? All right, let's see. You know, you need to give the attention to the mic because I can't help you.
We said that God was a God of organization.
Uh-huh. Yes, all right, he's not the God of confusion.
Chaos.
Yeah, that's right. He's organized, and wonderful lesson about small groups, isn't it? That he works in small groups. Aren't there somebody up here? Angela, look on the, did you want, in the pretty pink sweater, did you want to say something? Did she have her hand up? No? Go ahead, whatever.
Whatever. Verse previous to this, came up in our group of sharing what you have.
Yes. Yes, all right, so even if you think it's not enough, you go ahead and share what you have and let him make it enough. All right, good. Going on to verse 15, he had told them to have them sit down in groups of 50, and in verse 15, they did, the disciples did, everyone sat.
Obey Jesus' instructions.
Obey Jesus' instructions, that we need to be obedient to what he tells us to do. All right, any other lesson from there? Okay, Angela?
The disciples, they had power to be like an authority. When there was all these other people, and you just have 12 of them, and they were able to tell all these people, do this, do this, do this, do this, and they did it.
Okay. All right, so let's draw a lesson from that when God calls us to serve him, he can give us a certain authority that people recognize, right? So that whether it's leading in your church or leading in your neighborhood, maybe a Bible study, that God can give people who lead an authority that other people will follow. So, all right, that's a very interesting lesson. Angela?
Don't doubt.
Okay, don't doubt, just do it. You may not understand it. I'm sure they didn't understand why they were doing this, but they just did what Jesus said. Let's go on to verse 16. When he took the loaves and fish, gave thanks, broke them, gave them to the disciples, set them before the people. Lots of lessons there. Okay, right here.
Be thankful for what you do have.
Okay, to be thankful for what you have, even if it seems like a little bit. All right, Brandy?
I thought it was great significance that no matter what the position that Jesus has is like the highest person in the entire world. Yeah. He said his grace. Like he said his grace, and we forget to do that all the time, but he is Jesus, and he said his grace.
You know, that's isn't that precious? So one lesson for us, doesn't matter who we are, what our position is, we need to make time before we eat to thank the Lord for the food. And my children and I, you know, there's so many now food allergies and this gluten stuff and all that kind of stuff. And we've just seen that the blessing on the food before we eat it maybe has more importance than just thanking God for it, but asking his blessing that what we eat would agree with us, right? So I just think that's the sweetest thing. And I don't think it was a pretty dangerous thing in front of 5,000 hungry men to be thanking God for 5 loaves and 2 fish. You know, and so there was a huge expectancy on the part of Jesus also that God was going to do something. So let's go to the, all right, in the back. Linda, go ahead. Yeah, go ahead.
Similar to what you were first saying, but he prayed to God first and asked for help to make 5 loaves, turn it enough to feed everybody. Before he did anything else, he prayed first.
Okay. All right, so the lesson is that we need to pray first. And ask God, we can step out in faith and take the little bit that he's given us to pass it. But if it's going to be a blessing to others and feed others, we have to pray and just pray first. And ask God to bless what we attempt to do for him. Let's go to the last verse. All ate and were satisfied. The disciples picked up 12 baskets of broken pieces. There are Sheila's leftovers. Okay, Linda.
God is bigger than our needs and can give us more than we ask for.
Okay. You know, bigger than our needs and give us more than we ask for. And you know, it's a wonderful lesson when they gave him 5 loaves and 2 fish, had they hung on to it and been selfish and said, no, we have to have this for ourselves. We're not going to share it. They would have had a lot less, right? When they gave God everything, they ended up with more than they had to begin with. What a lesson is that? That God will bless us and give us more as we expend ourselves for him. Brandy, did you have something?
We'll all be satisfied if we just obey and believe in Jesus.
All right. So we'll be satisfied if we obey and believe in, and they were serving him, right? So I think one lesson might be, too, that he satisfies us in our service. Because when they took up 12 baskets of leftovers, that was one basket for each disciple. So each disciple who had served Jesus had something that would be used to feed themselves. So they were satisfied as a result. All right, I'm going to wrap that up. But you see what we're doing, and I know we've done this sort of quickly, but you go verse by verse and you're looking for the lesson, then take the lesson and or take the fact and draw a lesson from it, something you can learn from it. There's so many things in this passage to learn from it. As you can look at it from Jesus's point of view or the disciples or the people. But now I want you to go through and let's answer the next question. What does it mean in my life? And do what one of you had already done, where you take the lesson, put it in the form of a question that you would ask yourself or your children or somebody else. And when you do, see if you can hear God speaking to you through the passage. Because I can't tell you how many times I've written out my facts and then I've come up with my lessons. And as I take the lesson and put it in the form of a question to ask myself, as my pen goes across the page, I can hear God speaking to my heart. So open up your ears and see as you write these lessons in the form of a question, see if God will speak to you through this passage. And I'll give you about 6 or 8 minutes to do that. And you can do this with the person beside you, you can do this in your small group, or you can do this on your own. Whatever's most meaningful. But I'll give you about 8 minutes to see if you can find a lesson, put it in the form of a question from each one of those verses. But meditate on the one that seemed most special to you. On this side, and thank you all. You all were terrific, all right? And to go first is a challenge, but now you all have gotten the hang of it. If you want to answer, you just raise your hand, get the attention of the microphone, and I don't know whether to go verse by verse. We'll try to go verse by verse, but sometimes God speaks to several people through one verse, you know, so I don't want to limit us too much. But in verse 10, did anybody have a lesson that you put in the form of a question from verse 10? Brandy.
Hi, sometimes when I'm really going through, I wonder, do I really trust in the Lord?
All right, do we trust in the Lord? And from verse 10, when they came and reported to him, do I trust him enough to tell him about what's been going on in my day or what's going on in my life? Okay, anybody else? All right, let's go on to verse 11. So does somebody have a lesson that you put in the form of a question from verse 11? Okay, right here.
My question is, am I following Christ the way he wants me to follow? And when he speaks, am I listening and obeying?
All right, good, okay. And do I know that when I come to him, I'm always welcomed? You know, that they weren't an interruption. All right, Angela.
Do I take time for others?
Okay, good. Maybe how do I view interruptions? You know, what's my response when I get interrupted? And verse 12. Somebody have a lesson that you put in the form of a question from verse 12? Okay, Angela, anybody? Okay, hold on a minute.
Am I talking to God or at God?
Okay, so they're trying to tell him how to handle things. So am I telling him what to do or am I listening to what he has to say? Okay, Brandy.
Mine is very similar, but do I tell God what to do rather than allowing him to control the situation?
Yes, okay, and sometimes when we pray, that's what we're sort of telling him in prayer, aren't we? We're telling him how to answer our prayer instead of just stating the need and let him come up with the answer. All right, okay, over here.
I asked myself, do I trust God to provide in the remote times of my life? In the wilderness times.
Yes, okay. Do I trust God to provide for me in those hard times? And when the disciples told, you know, Jesus to dismiss them, really they were saying these people are somebody else's responsibility. So who am I sort of passing off and saying that's not my responsibility? Who am I unwilling to help because I think it's not my job? All right, let's go to verse, is it 14? Am I 14? When he had them sit in small groups. Am I 13? Okay, thank you. So that was what I just did, right? Sorry. I got ahead of myself. Go ahead.
Where can I minister with the resources I currently have? And is that going to be time or money or strength or knowledge?
Okay.
Can be different things.
Yes, okay. And if I think it's not enough, then am I willing to give it to God to make enough? You know, so sometimes we don't give them because we think it's so insignificant. Okay, right here.
Do I accept God's order and sequence in how my life unfolds?
Okay. You know, and when he told him to break up in the small groups, do I accept him just organizing my life and the sequence of things, the way things fall out? Okay, good. And then I think now we're down to verse 15, are we? Where the disciples did what he told them, everybody sat down. Anybody who took that and put it in the form of a question? All right, Linda, in back of you, there's some. I think you can reach them. All right, there you go.
Do I allow God to lead me?
Do I allow God to lead me? All right. And next to her?
Am I being obedient in leading others?
Yes. Okay. And, you know, sometimes we want a miracle, but one of the requirements is that we be obedient, right? And so if I'm still waiting for a miracle, have I been obedient to what God's told me to do? And in verse 16, anybody have a lesson that you put in the form of a question in verse 16? Okay, Angela?
Am I giving thanks before seeing the answers to my prayers?
Okay, all right. Am I giving thanks before I see the answers to my prayers? That's a powerful one. Brandy, are you with somebody? Yes, okay.
Am I giving thanks for the broken things in my life?
Yes, okay. You know, God can use broken pieces. Am I willing to give God my broken pieces? And yes, right here.
Kind of the same thing. Do I give thanks and pray even when I'm broken?
Okay, do I give thanks and pray even when I'm broken? Or maybe pray over the broken pieces, which is what he was doing, right, Linda? Okay, let's go to the last verse. Does somebody have one from verse 17, a lesson that you put in the form of a question? Anybody from over here? Okay, Linda, yes.
I wrote, will God not provide what I need and even more abundantly than I can imagine if I simply obey and trust his heart?
Yes, okay. So maybe if I don't have what I need, is it because I haven't given everything to him? Yes.
I wrote down, am I truly satisfied with God's provision, or do I still want fake and false goods such as artificial sweetener? Do I live in the real sweet life, or do I want the fake sweetener?
Okay. Okay, thank you. All right, Angela, do you have somebody?
Why do I question that God will meet and exceed my needs?
Yes, okay. Why would I question that God would not see my needs and meet my needs? And Brandy?
I really picked up on that, and they ate and were satisfied. So I've got, well, I let Jesus be my salvation.
Okay, all right, and will I allow him to satisfy, am I hard to satisfy maybe? You know, and maybe if I'm not satisfied, is it because I'm not serving? I don't think they would have been satisfied had they not given everything to him. All right, anybody else from any of the verses? Just give us the verse number and the lesson and how you put it in the form of a question. Anybody? All right, Linda.
Verse 17, I have what can I do with what's left over?
All right, Sheila, there you go. Somebody has gotten her lesson. What can I do with my leftovers? And, you know, that was Sheila's thing, that God can make over leftovers, right? All right, Brandy?
I'd say when the disciples came back and reported to Jesus, and then he took them privately,
yes.
My question would be, for myself, how deep in relationship is my intimacy level with you, Christ? Am I asking, seeking, or am I knocking?
You know, thank you. And I'm going to end on that one because that's a very, that's a great lesson. It's a fundamental lesson. And they came and reported to Jesus, and they talked to him privately. And there seems to be some time that they were with him alone before the crowd came. And so we need to serve, and we need to be out there doing what he's telling us to do. But we shouldn't substitute that for our own private time with the Lord, right? So if I lack an intimate relationship with Jesus, is it because I'm not giving him that private time? That's great. Thank you for, that's a wonderful way to wrap this up. And you all have been fabulous. Thank you. And there's, you know, we could stay here for another hour and work the whole room and come up with different lessons and different questions. Isn't it wonderful? And you've just done that so quickly. You haven't had time to even think that through, except the little bit of time I gave you. And look at what you got from it.